been having dreams, jumping on a trampoline, flipping in the air. I never land, just float there. As I'm looking up, suddenly the sky erupts. Flames alert the trees, spread to fallen leaves. Now they're fire upon me. Wait, if I'm on fire, how am I so deep in love when I dream of dying? I never feel so alive. I've been having in the summer stream, tripping, I fall in. I wanted it to happen. My body turns to ice, crushing weight of paradise. Solid block of gold, lying in the cold. I feel right.
Intellectual property, one of the most difficult concepts for new people to libertarians. I can't even speak tonight, so this is going to be great. I'm recovering from COVID, excuse me. One of the often most difficult concepts for people new to libertarian principle, or even people that have been in libertarian principle for years, to really get their head around the idea that intellectual property is not a valid form of property, causes a lot of people to really struggle to sort of let go of ownership of ideas and patterns and things that often their incomes are tied to. So me as a photographer, me as a software developer, my entire life, my entire career, my entire income for most of my life is wrapped up in intellectual property. And when I was first confronted with these ideas, it was a long, hard fight for me to really make a commitment to reason and evidence and rational thought, to work my way through the debates to figure out these concepts. And so when talking to other people about this concept now, man, I have so much patience and I just really enjoy this topic. I think it's fun, engaging, exciting. And not only that, man, the group that we have today, this is some of my favorite people in the entire world, and we're bringing them, like a lot of them, on the show all at once. Let's get into it. He has a plan, she has a plan, and you get to pay for it regardless.
The best way to get someone motivated is to stand for something strongly, deeply, passionately.
Subscribe to Disenthrall.
Do as you're told.
Without further ado, welcome everyone to Disenthrall. Great to have you all here. How are you?
Wonderful. Fantastic. Thanks for having us on.
We have, let's see, James, you're muted, I think. Going clockwise, we have James Freeman, yep. Top left. We have Shepherd, the voluntarist, middle, center, top. And bottom left, we have Christian from Liberty After Dark. One of my favorite philosopher partners that we've been working on a lot of really cool stuff together that maybe we'll share in the future. But today, let me just kind of kick this thing off by telling the lead up, right? So we have a Telegram group where we communicate to coordinate shows and topics and ideas and things like that. And James kicked off a discussion about intellectual property, challenging sort of all of us to think about it again. Anew. And so rather than have a private conversation that no one would potentially benefit from, I said, hey, let's get this on the tubes so that more people can benefit from it and we can actually talk through it again. Because again, like, this is great stuff. This is what people need to learn how to do more, is have a friendly, engaging and clashing of ideas and concepts. So James, I'm just gonna like hand the show to you, and you can like approach it however you want. Take your positions however you want to take them, and let's do this.
All right. Can you hear me now? Am I unmuted now?
Yes.
All right, cool. Sorry, I had it muted there for a minute.
It's my strategy. Like, when I'm debating somebody, I leave them muted. It makes winning so much easier.
It's the best way to do it.
Yeah.
The last time that I was on your show, you had asked me briefly about, I was having an issue with somebody who was on TikTok. And it looks like my entire screen just froze up now.
I can hear you. You're good. You're good on our end, at least.
All right.
I don't know if you can hear us.
Okay. So somebody had taken and basically was impersonating me on TikTok, pretending to be me, and had taken all of my videos from YouTube and was uploading them to TikTok. And previously, I've never cared about people using my videos. At that point, it was really just the impersonation that really took it too far and made me decide to do something about it and shut it down. And so that was when the topic of intellectual property came up, and I had never even thought about it or addressed it either publicly or even in my own mind before, even though I've been libertarian for a long time. It just had never, there was never a reason for me to even think about it, I guess. And so you had mentioned it briefly to me, and, at the time, I hadn't looked into it much. I didn't have an opinion one way or the other, really. And so over the last few weeks, I've had months, actually, I think it's been a couple of months, had some time to look at some stuff, and I am not wrapping my head around this the way that I want to. So I'm almost at a point right now where I feel like if intellectual property doesn't exist, then neither does any other sort of private property. But also, I'm at a point where I feel like there are some things that are considered intellectual property that I don't think are intellectual property, and other things that are considered intellectual property that I do believe are property. For example, let me say, I came up with the idea of Spider-Man, and I make a movie called Spider-Man. I think that I own that movie. And I think that for you to take an exact copy of that movie and take it and sell it, I think would be a violation of my property. Now, on the other hand, the idea of Spider-Man, the entire concept, I don't think that I should be able to own an idea. So if you think you can make a better movie using my exact idea, then I think you should have the right to go do that, but not necessarily take my actual production and sell it and make money off of it. So that's kind of where I'm at, and I wanted to hear from you guys, and you know, if I'm totally wrong here, I just can't wrap my head around it.
So I guess I want to kind of split our time up as equally as possible, not for the commune's sake, but just because we all have a lot of good ideas and I want to give everybody a chance to voice them. So, Christian, why don't we go James just spoke. Let's go Christian, then Shepherd, and then me. How about that? Is that good?
Yeah, sure. So just a little opening statement, I guess, or,
or a response to James, whatever you want to do. It's your time.
My conception of property is pretty much I think it's a pretty typical, I will say learned position on property. It's like a fusion of Rothbardian and some Hoppe principles. All rights are property rights. I think that's something that we can agree on. I think what the distinction of what the definition of property is really important. So what makes your body property in like a bicycle property versus what, you know, we will propose intellectual property is not property. It's a value of scarcity. And I think it's something really critical that we have to keep in mind. But there's also another perspective of looking at this that I think is very important. And it's that intellectual property is just a rule someone developed that tells another person what they can and can't do with their own property. So for example, if you were to write or let's say you made the Spider-Man movie, we'll stick with the same analogy just to keep things simple. To say that if I wanted to take a VCR or a DVD burner, I don't know if the VCR is too old for some of these people, but if we wanted to take a DVD burner and burn an exact copy of your, with my machine onto my disc of your Spider-Man movie, that would technically be a violation of your intellectual property to do so. But that would be saying that I can't do what I want with my property because of your intellectual property rights. So we have some conflict there that has to be resolved. And I think that's pretty much the easiest way to like kind of jump into where I'm standing at this point.
Shepherd?
Yeah, and I think your example, James, is a very good one. And I think this kind of brings up an interesting point that I have learned from Patrick and Christian. And that is kind of that bright line difference between will you initiate violence in response to something, or is it just aesthetically bad? And so I think there are certain things that are really uncool, man, and I'm not going to be your friend anymore if you do that. And then there are other things that I'll come over and shoot you. And that's kind of where the difference comes in between did you steal my child and sell them into a prostitution ring, or did you take my idea to film cops misbehaving and then do something with that? So I guess for me, just because something is wrong or uncool doesn't necessarily make it immoral or worthy of initiating violence. So I don't know. That's kind of the bright line that I have to look at. And I've got to say, I've got to join with you and say, I am not entirely convinced in all aspects of intellectual property, not being actual property either. So I'm yet to be completely persuaded as well.
All right. Well, unbeknownst to all of you, while you were talking, I spent a little bit of time robbing you of a little bit of your control over your property. So I have constructed this picture, which I now it's just because I'm not a good artist. That's why it always looks the same.
This is the pinnacle of my Christian. That's good.
This is the pinnacle of my capacity. Okay, shut up. So I now have an inviolable property right in the pattern that is this image. And through the power and magic of intellectual property and the guns of government that is needed to create it and enforce it, I now have a sliver of control over every single piece of property that you own. If you arrange any of your property in a pattern that looks similar enough to this, I now can use force to prevent you from doing that with your property or to steal money from you for having done that from you, to me, to my pattern, by aggressing upon my property rights in this pattern through intellectual property. So that is the clearest way I can describe that intellectual property cannot coexist with normal, traditional conceptions of property. They are incompatible. They conflict. You can either have ownership in a piece of property, and the best definition for ownership that I've ever heard is ownership is the right to exclude other people from the use of a thing. So if we, I guess we need to agree on definitions to really proceed in this discussion, right? But I'm going to propose that as the best definition for ownership, the right to exclude others from a use of a thing. I have now diminished your ownership. I can now exclude you from using your own actual property. I just did right here. And that, I guess that's my first.
Draw? That's me, right?
I thought that was Christian.
It kind of looks like an old pro wrestler. I don't know.
I'm not prepared to answer the. Am I being detained or am I free to go, James Freeman? my primary point is that ownership is the right to exclude other people from the use of a thing, of property. That intellectual property as a form of property necessarily conflicts with actual property ownership. And I know saying actual is begging the question, but I think you know what I mean. Like, we'll say traditional property. The two can't really coexist. One necessarily conflicts and diminishes the other, necessarily increasing rivalrousness, which just means the conflict over property. And in so doing, reduces the system's viability at being a good system of property. Because a system of property exists to reduce the conflict over scarce resources, which kind of brings me to my point two. My phase two is the whole point of property is to reduce conflict over scarce resources. And there is nothing scarce about intellectual property, about patterns, about ways that you arrange matter. There's nothing scarce about that. They can be duplicated infinitely. Not counting like artificial means of sort of faking scarcity, which would get into like a Bitcoin discussion, but I don't think that's what we're here to talk about. So I'm going to leave Bitcoin out of it for now, unless you want to go there. Okay. So that would be my intro. James, okay. Back to you.
So I still see I understand and comprehend that you can't own an idea. I certainly understand that. But let me use another analogy, I guess. Maybe I built a house, right? And I've got these blueprints, and the blueprints are essentially the idea for the house that I'm going to build, right? And when I build the house, the house is tangible property and I own it, but essentially the blueprints, the idea of how to build the house is not property, I guess, right? It's intellectual property. And that's where I would say that I would agree that these blueprints, I don't own them. Anybody can take them, use them, reuse them, and build their own house. But I don't think that they have the right to my house. And I feel like with content or videos that you create or photographs that you take, that the idea of taking a wedding photograph is not yours. But I think that if you took that wedding photograph, a specific one, that I think that you would have a property right over that, just in similar ways to how you would have a property right over a house that you built, but not necessarily the idea of how you built it. And especially if you're using that for your livelihood. Like you said, you used photographs to make a living. And so I'm not saying that nobody else can go take pictures to make a living. I'm just saying that those specific ones that you took, essentially you created those. That's now a creation. And I do see a scarcity to it because there's only probably one or two people that are going to want to buy those specific pictures from you. There might be a handful that want some generic wedding pictures, but I think there is a scarcity because there's only a couple of people that are going to want to buy that. And that's the people who are in the wedding, right? And so if I go and undercut you and I take your pictures and copy them and go and sell them to the people that you took photos of, I think that is a violation of your property rights.
Christian?
Yeah, not to get too bogged down in definitions or anything, but I think it's really important to note that there's like, you could say that there's a scarcity of demand for a particular item, but that's not necessarily the scarcity that we're talking about. Like there, if there's only so much paper in the universe to print a picture on, you know, there's only so many atoms that can be arranged to make these pieces of paper that you can print, you know, whatever. There's a limit, right? And whether it's that one piece of paper that exists that has that picture on it, or a thousand of them, those are scarce things that you can hold in your hand and say, I own this piece of paper with the picture on it. But if I was to scan that pattern, that image, and create another completely unique piece of paper that would be just as much mine, and kind of coming back to where we were earlier, to say that I couldn't do that with my piece of paper is necessarily limiting what I can do with my own property. So again, I don't want to get too wrapped up in definitions, but I think it's important to note that like a scarcity of demand, you know, it doesn't particularly matter in this situation. We're talking about like a physical scarcity of objects. And that's something that, you know, like digital photography is a great example, or even the pattern printed on the actual image, because once you have the physical image, yeah, that's property. Nobody's going to contest that. But like a digital photo, for example, if you were to copy, you know, Control C off of Google or something and take an image, I'm sure most of us have done that. And we've probably violated somebody's intellectual property rights in doing so at more than one point. If you've done a good amount of Google, oh, this would be great for a thumbnail image searching or something like that. So I think there's not only are there tons of ramifications for looking at it from that perspective, I just don't think it matches up with like the actual meaning of scarcity and why it exists in the first place in relation to property.
Shepard, any thoughts?
I can't argue with the philosophy that Christian is talking about. And this kind of goes back to a lot of the arguments against pure libertarianism, voluntarism, which is, well, I don't like the outcome of this intellectual thought process, and therefore it's got to be wrong. Well, not necessarily. But I think about the person who takes that photograph that waited for the perfect lighting and went out every morning, staying at a hotel at night and getting up every morning for weeks on end until the perfect lighting hit. And they had all the expensive gear, like they've invested so much, and they take this beautiful picture and they're proud of it. And they put it on Facebook and they're planning to sell it all over. Well, the moment they put it on the Book of Faces, everybody else is taking it and using it. And it just doesn't seem fair. Now, fairness, or what doesn't seem fair to a snowflake like me, doesn't necessarily mean something is immoral, but it just seems like there should be a better way. And I don't know what that is.
Okay. Let me try and speak to some of those points. So the first thing I guess I wanted to call out was right to profit. You do not possess a right to profit on any endeavor, any bit of labor, any property that you own. You can't sort of enslave the people around you into giving you something in exchange for your property. That's, you know, clearly wrong. And that's full stop across the board. No matter what conception of property you have, there is no right to profit off anything you do. And that goes directly to what value is being subjective. All value is subjective. And that just means that everything, it has to be valued by a person to be thought of or considered to have any value. And the value that that thing has is individual, up to each individual person to assess its value and decide how much it's valued in between zero to infinite. You know, and infinite's probably something along the lines of, you know, their life would be like something they would exchange for an infinite value. Like they would, like my kids' lives are of infinite value to me, and so I would sacrifice my own on their behalf. That would be kind of that extreme. So in the same way that property doesn't have inherent value and that the value of property is subjective, so too is labor. The labor theory of value that we hear from the communists is also, of course, very invalid and wrongheaded. You know, if you and I both make the same widget, and I make it in a way that takes 20 times as much effort and work and time and resources to produce, and we both hold our objects out in front of ourselves and they're both identical, the result is identical, but my labor and what I put into it was way higher, that doesn't mean that my item is going to sell for more or that it has some kind of inherently higher value than your item that you made much more cheaply and efficiently, let's say. And so the fact that a photographer may have, you know, sat in a deer blind for 200 hours until the perfect buck walked by in the perfect lighting with the sunset and the perfect angle, and he captured the shot, and the shot is gorgeous, and maybe a lot of people value it, doesn't mean that any of that labor contributed any of that value to it. It's still up to the individual people valuing that photo, the people that would offer something in exchange for that photo. Now, what constitutes that photo would be probably thought of as a pattern. That's what intellectual property is. It's a pattern that you arrange tangible property in some way. So we're not talking about, like to Christian's point, the piece of paper that has the picture on it, or the, you know, printed picture itself, that's property. You have an ownership right in it, the right to exclude other people from using that item. But the pattern inscribed on it, or the arrangement of atoms on that piece of paper, there's no property right in that, because there's no scarcity in it. There's no inherent value in it. So if somebody copies it a million times, you've lost no value. No, you've lost nothing. You may have lost maybe an opportunity to have value, but again, there's no right in opportunity. There's no right to property that can be taken from you. If there was, imagine the myriad of problems that would cause everyone. Anytime you did anything that affected anybody else's ability to make money, you would be in violation of their right to profit rights, which could be anything. Like, if I don't cut my grass for a couple extra days, it might marginally decrease the property value of the people living next to me, and their right to profit would have been violated, and I would owe restitution for them. Like, just to kind of give that as an example of why that's not a thing. So those are my thoughts. I guess we are back to James.
Those are excellent points that actually help clarify things quite a bit, guys. Yeah, as far as right to profit, I mean, obviously there is value on the picture that you took, right, to somebody. Well, I wouldn't say obviously, but when you took that photograph of that buck or whatever, you know what? I don't know. I'm lost.
Oh no! Let's bring you back from being lost. And I talked for a long time, but there was one more thing I wanted to lay out. Can I interrupt the circle of life
to
address one more thing? Is that, do I have everyone's consent? Fairness. I wanted to talk to Shepard's fairness. And I wanted to talk to the other side of intellectual property and an alternative way that it can be enforced. But I'm not using force as actual force. I just mean a way that it can be a thing. And that is that in a lot of ways and a lot of times, I 100% agree that copying somebody's work and making it available to the general public for free, which can be said to cause them to lose some profit, is a really, really, really shitty fucking thing to do. And you shouldn't do it. And if you know somebody that's doing it, you should probably disassociate from them. You should probably tell everyone around you that they're doing it, because they're just, it's shitty behavior. A perfect example is Larkin Rose's Candles in the Dark seminars that he sells on his website.
Yep.
There is an asshole out there that has downloaded, that has paid to access the content, in which the paying process, you have to agree to not download and share it. He agreed to that, paid for it, downloaded it, and shared it in a Telegram group. Now, do we have a property right claim against this guy? Can I go, if I find him, and kick his ass until I get restitution for what I've lost or what Larkin's lost? No. But by God, can I expose him for the person that is causing Larkin to not be able to make a living off of something that the world definitely needs? And if Larkin can't make a living off something the world definitely needs, then he's not going to be able to make as much of what the world definitely needs. And that kind of hurts everybody. So that's really deeply shitty behavior. And that person needs to be exposed and disassociated from in the most loud terms possible. So I think that's the other side of intellectual property. Like, if I work hard on something and somebody takes that and distributes it freely, especially, you know, without any kind of permission or anything like that, this is not something I can attack him over. That's the line. But it's definitely shitty behavior that I think people should and probably would want to act against in consensual ways. So sorry to interrupt. Back to whoever wants it next. Who wants it next? Christian or James, you want to go back to you? What do you think?
I just wanted to say in Daniel Earl.
Yeah.
Oh, everybody talked. Great. All right. James, go first. Sorry.
I just want to say, and Daniel Earl mentioned it in the chat as well. Well, that's contract violation. And you know, sure, intellectual property isn't a thing, especially recognized by libertarians and anarchists. Gosh, if you and I both voluntarily agree to something and then sign a contract on it, that's something completely different.
You're right. And that was a bad example. But let's say that that agreement wasn't there and he did that. I would still consider right. that deeply shitty behavior. But yeah, you're right. That is a contract violation. And there's probably rightful restitution involved. But I guess that was a bad example. I apologize.
Well, I don't want to go too far off on this tangent, but was there a or I'll kick your ass clause in the contract, or was it just like a general pledge? Because if there's no damages associated in the contract, you'd have a difficult time seeking that restitution. But that's true. So that was actually, I saw the comment and I was like, I don't want to go down that tangent, but I'm glad you brought it up because I wanted to get that out there. Contracts are fickle things. Make sure if you want something out of them, put penalty.
Yeah, I take credit. It was a bad example. So for the purposes of this discussion, if we want to continue using that, let's say that contract was not part of the purchase. Let's just simplify it by saying that he got it, downloaded it, and shared it. And that sucks for Larkin.
Yeah. I take a similar route with this with like art. I'm kind of like a lame beta male cuck, some people would say. So I really enjoy a digital art, and I have quite a large portfolio of it. And I buy most of it from artists who put it up online. What? I did a meme.
Oh, okay. Oh no.
Help me take this mask off.
But you'll die.
I hit the wrong button.
Well, I like that one anyways.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I did a meme. Sorry, I derailed the whole conversation trying to get a funny in. But I buy a lot of the digital art that I have, and I don't... Technically speaking, you don't have to. You can just copy it because most of them put it out there without a watermark. And they're like, hey, if you want this in 8K or whatever, so you can blow it up and print it real nice. If you want it in your house or something, you can buy it here, or you can, you know, here's the 4K version I put up on the website. You know, the inferior one or something. And I pay for it because I, you know, usually it's like $5-$10 and I like people making art. So I like to support them in doing that. But I, you know, like Patrick was saying, I couldn't like bash someone's face in as a property rights violator because they took some random, you know, poster's art and printed it or copied it or any of those things. And I think it's just one of the things that I wanted to say, and maybe this will kind of help bring us around, is that this is one of those topics that I think is like a really clinical answer to it that doesn't have... It doesn't have like good feels really associated with it. Like I think some of the things we talk about do. Like when we talk about an individual's right to protect themselves, or when we talk about ownership of a person's body, total complete self-ownership, these things are like really powerful. They feel good. They're empowering. But because of the way that we've been taught about intellectual property as a protection for the creator, we don't see it as the detriment to the people, we'll say to the consumers, for lack of a better word. And their rights. So it creates kind of a trepidatious headspace where we think about it as like we're giving something up, when in reality, what we're doing is we're redispersing those rights that people lost to do what they want with their property to those other people. So it's hard to get like the feel good message coming away from this determination, but it is there. You just kind of have to look opposite of where they want you to look to see it.
Shepherd to you, and you can pass if you don't have anything to say. Like you own yourself.
You know, I have never tried that before. Having the opportunity to speak and not speaking—that's you know what? I want to try it though. Can I do that right now?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, yeah. Cool. I'm gonna try it.
Okay. I'm just going to look at you for a while. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, well, I'm good looking, so I might as well say something. So here's...
Oh, it was a deception. Now you're going to talk.
Well, oh, you're going to scare me. I'm going to come back on this. I have an opportunity to talk. I can't. No, I thought I could, and I can't. I can't. So the idea of that we've talked about in the past when we've argued about this, having to do with a Bitcoin key and going into the wallet and taking all of the Bitcoin, the thing of value, out of there. I think there's so many areas of this that there's... Just because there isn't a good... pure moral libertarian solution, or as Christian called it, like a feel-good solution, doesn't mean something is necessarily immoral. However, I think we should, as people who are thinkers, and we like to kind of sit around and have a beer and talk about this stuff, I mean, how do we solve these issues? What should James do if somebody is taking his hard work, his little ones and zeros pattern on a videotape, and they're taking that, and because they take it, they're profiting from it, and he is not financially. What is the solution? What do we do?
Yeah, go ahead, James.
Yeah, I want you guys to know too. I think the four of you probably know. I don't know if the audience does that. I don't actually even try to claim my alleged intellectual property. It's just that I can't wrap my head around it. But I've always liked that people take my content and copy it and share it because I like that the ideas are getting out there. I like that other than the one instance where the guy literally tried to impersonate me, I don't think that I've really ever gone after someone for taking in one of my videos. Actually, there was another time where somebody took every single video and made it look like he was. So, but yeah, I don't go after people for it. At the same time, though, like I said, I can't wrap my head around and comprehending how this actually aligns with libertarian principles and property. You know, for example, again, let's go back to the picture, the stupid wedding picture, Patrick. You were going to sell it to the bride and the groom, but I go and rip it off and I sell it to the bride and the groom. I still feel like I just outright stole that from you. I get it was my piece of paper. But and it's, I don't know, I guess that there's different scenarios in whether it's morally right or wrong, and when it's, you know, as far as principles go, as far as following libertarian principles, when it does and doesn't violate. I'm just not entirely grasping it. I do understand when it's morally right or wrong. Like, I would not do that to you. I can't say that I'm completely grasping how it follows these libertarian principles.
Let's spend some time then answering Shepard's question and taking the pressure off to show other ways that the photographer could profit in that example, for example. So when I shot weddings, which I did, I've shot quite a few weddings, I charged up front. My fee was not based on individual pictures. It was based on, you know, a service fee for shooting the wedding. At the end of it, they got all the pictures. Well, I did half up front and half after it was done, you know, because it makes the customer feel better and is a better sales tactic, for example. But, you know, as long as they paid me, they got all the pictures. So I didn't lose any money. And even if I had allowed somebody free access to my hard drive and somebody had grabbed all those pictures and shared them with the newlyweds, it wouldn't have mattered to me at all because I had a contract that was based on an half up front, half upon completion fee. So right there, that's the first way that a lot of these things can be mitigated just by different kinds of contracts. And a lot of intellectual property can be simulated through contract. For example, like the Larkin thing, rather than depend on intellectual property as a form of property. And, you know, for example, the guns of governments to shut this guy that was sharing Larkin's videos down. We made a contract with them. Hey, if you're buying this as part of the agreement, you agree to not download and share these with other people. That's a contract that effectively created intellectual property, at least in that way. Now, if we had included like a punishment clause, that would have been more stringent, of course, to Christian's point, but I don't want to get into those details today. But yeah, so I'm just saying, like, we could have put execution in the contract, you know, for this person that, you know, downloaded and shared this media. And if he agreed to it, if he consented to it, then you have your intellectual property by consensual voluntary agreement with the people sharing it. The only difference really between what you can accomplish with contracts and modern intellectual property is that third parties that aren't party to that contract, that didn't sign shit, so to speak, there's no social contract involved. If they found a way to acquire those videos, they wouldn't be bound by any contract to share them themselves on the side. That's the main difference. And that's the shitty behavior that I think should be ostracized over. Another thing is that a lot of people are concerned about like the creative types and their ability to monetize their work to keep them creating. For example, like, what was the author of the Harry Potter series? I can't remember her name, but you know, she's releasing successively, you know, like annually for a while. She was releasing one book a year ish. And early on, the value of those books was low before anybody knew about them. No one would have really cared, and she probably wouldn't have made much money on them. J.K. Rowling, thank you, Daniel. But later, you know, after she had had the sixth movie in the series, one way for her to monetize that without depending at all on intellectual property would have been to do a GoFundMe campaign. Hey, you want me to release the next book? Sign up here. Donate $20, $50. Not only in exchange for your support for Harry Potter 7, you will get to be one of the first people to see it in theaters, for example. Like, you have the ability to control access to things, to your physical property, rightfully, thanks to property rights. So you don't have to release this stuff if you don't want to, and you can control how you release it, and you can monetize the release of that art, for example. So there's a myriad of ways that we can invent in the free market to monetize creative works, which is just another way of saying labor, right? We're just talking about labor. The photographer's doing labor to take pictures. J.K. Rowling's doing labor to write these stories, and people are doing labor to produce, you know, to turn them into movies. And so there's a ton of ways to monetize that labor that don't depend on intellectual property. Who wants to go next?
I guess I could pick this up, and maybe we can. I kind of wanted to touch on one thing specifically that James said, which was a reference to stealing. And I think it could be useful just to kind of like go over what constitutes theft and like why theft is something we care about at all, right? And the way that it was being used here is that the stealing is happening because a potential gain for the person was being mitigated in the case of selling the wedding photo, right? You're stealing the client. But that's not like what stealing actually is in like a conception of property rights, right? Because for something to be stolen, it must be scarce to the extent that when it is stolen, you are without it. It is gone from your person, because property is an extension of your person. So, IP doesn't really fall under the realm of stealing for a lot of different reasons, but even just sticking to the analogy that we had, the client that was going to pay you for the photo can only colloquially be referred to as stolen, because it's not like they are a scarce resource that is already a part of your person that someone is depriving you of that you already had a proper claim to, right? That is what constitutes theft. That's what constitutes stealing. If those criteria aren't met, nothing has been stolen, like, definitionally. That's just the way that the term works. But I understand that I'm trying to clarify that there's a bit of a distinction between like how we might be using it in like a technical sense and like a more colloquial usage of it.
Yeah, thank you. That makes complete and total sense. Basically, by saying that, you know, I would be stealing from Patrick, I would really be saying that I owned his customer, and that his customer never had a right to decide whether they wanted to do business with Patrick or me, that they had to do business with one or the other. So yeah, that makes total sense. You don't own the customer. You don't own anybody. So to say that that was stealing would be to say that I owned another individual.
Thomas, I never know how to say his last name, so we're going to go with Thomas over on Odyssey, tipped 200. Sir, thank you. I always appreciate your support and dropping by. It's good to see you. Thanks for supporting the show. Okay, so do we want to, let's open it up for comments and questions. Guys, if you have any challenges for us, if you have any questions for us, if you think anybody on your screen right now got something wrong, say so, and we'll address your comments and take your questions and do what we can with them. Does anybody have anything to say while we kind of give people a chance to get their questions and comments in?
Yeah, I saw a comment asking, can birds own a song? And no, because they are state of nature beings. They are not privy to the considerations of rights. So I just figured I'd answer that one.
Yeah. Well, can you tell us why that is? What does it take to own? Who can be a property owner and why?
Well, you have to be someone who is elevated above the state of nature. And this is a whole conversation that actually Patrick and I did probably like 4 months ago now, over on my channel, where we talked all about the state of nature and why it's important for the conception of basically everything in philosophy. But a state of nature being is essentially someone or something that either does not have the capacity to reciprocate rights or willfully chooses not to do so. So they are not beholden to those same considerations. So a bird is not held to considerations for property rights because it does not respect your own property rights. It never would. If you left nuts on a table or something, the bird's going to take them. You know, it's not going to think, oh, the moral quandary of these nuts on this table. No, it's just going to take them and eat them. So that's one example of a state of nature being and why they are not due considerations of rights.
And, you know, to I guess James's point earlier, and I'll try and bolster his point a little bit just for the sake of the conversation. All property rights are agreements between people, and people can agree on anything. So they could agree between each other to treat intellectual property as a valid form of property and to reciprocate the ability to attack each other when those property rights reciprocated between them are violated. It's totally possible. You can have people that agree to do that, just like you can have people to agree to mangle property rights to the point where communes exist, for example. So people can reciprocate whatever property rights they want because these are just concepts held in people's minds and agreed on between individuals. I guess what is important, just to now reverse speak to the other side of that, is that if we are going to spend our time looking for and abiding by a system of property, then we need to give it the intellectual rigor that it deserves to make that system as universalizable, as simple, as rational, as non-contradictory, as completely possible. Because the whole point of doing it is to reduce conflict so that we're not beating each other over the head for, you know, the meat that we want, for example. So that we're not fighting constantly, tooth and fang, as the philosophers would say, over scarce resources. We need a system. Well, most of us agree that it's useful to have a system where we can reciprocate agreements to reduce conflict and back off of things when we agree according to a system of property that somebody else owns it and we don't, so we're not going to thump them over the head and take what we want. And so my challenge against people choosing to reciprocate intellectual property as a right is that it contradicts the other property rights, and in so doing makes that a worse system of property to reciprocate with people because it introduces conflict rather than eliminates it. If you want to live in a group of people that all understand and choose to reciprocate intellectual property rights with each other, man, that's y'all's voluntary commune. You can do whatever you'd like. So I guess that's something I think that's worth pointing out. Mr. G says, I'm having trouble understanding the difference between shitty behavior and something being immoral. Shepard brought this up in a video recently where he says that I challenged him to what standards that he has for the friends that he keeps and breaks bread with, so to speak. And I have a really high standard for my friends and the people that I allow to become close to me or, you know, enter my close orbits. My best friends are people that would unequivocally never, ever violate or attack anyone for any non-aggressive behavior. And Shepard's example is if somebody made kissy faces at my wife, you know, I might go punch them. Well, that would be bringing violence to the table of a nonviolent situation. That would be bringing force to bear against shitty behavior. And so that's the line. One is a property rights violation, an aggression, an initiation of force against somebody, and the other is shitty behavior. Shitty behavior can be anything that you choose it to be, and everybody's going to have their own ideas on what shitty behavior is. Kissy faces at your wife? for one person, they might like it in 2021. And to another person, it might be something that would make them very, very angry, right? So I call that aesthetics. Like, there is no objective answer to that. It's how you feel about it. You can consider something shitty behavior or not. But the reason why the line for me is what can be objectively shown in reality took place. And your feelings on something is not something that can really be objectively demonstrated in reality. But you punching somebody, that is an act that can be objectively verified and recorded. And that's you acting on somebody else's property. So that's kind of the line. It's aesthetics versus sort of objective reality and the actions taken against other people, consensual or otherwise. I don't know if I explained that well. Anybody else can definitely speak here. I'm going to keep reading comments.
But Patrick, and I'll jump in just to clarify my example.
Let me jump in also.
Christian, then Shepherd, then James.
No. I was just joking. I just said, but Patrick, what if we're all just brains in a vat? So you can go now, Shepherd.
And just to clarify, in my example, if a neighbor says, hey, don't make kissy faces at my wife or I'll kick your butt. And kind of my point was, if my neighbor said that and the neighbor was otherwise a very useful, good person, I'm not going to shun that neighbor. I'm still going to go help them with their barn raising and I'm still going to be their neighbor because that seems reasonable. It passes the reasonable person standard to me. Whereas I know that it does cross that line. And then I emphasize that we have to go along with what Patrick and Christian have talked about there being that bright line between something is moral if it is not initiating violence. If it's initiating violence, then it's not moral. Because while I might be okay with my neighbor having that rule about somebody making kissy faces at his wife, what if that rule wasn't making kissy faces? What if it was, I just don't like seeing Jews, you know, around our subdivision? Well, no, he can't have that rule. That I would have a real problem with. I'm okay with him saying you can't make kissy faces at my wife. So I guess if we're going to make a good solid rule that holds, then we have to say, yeah, I can't kick your butt for what you think or what you do. I can only kick your butt if you first try to kick mine.
So I talked for like anybody's butt. I talked for like 5 minutes answering that dude's question, and then Al Frodo in the comments says, Mr. G, the difference is that one would be justified in using force against another for engaging in immoral actions, but not for shitty behavior. Like, in a sentence, he did better than I did in 5 minutes, so well done. And then Mr. G cements my defeat in rhetoric by saying, thank you, I understood the way Al Frodo explained it. So.
Oh, man. It's a little overcooked, that idea, just a bit maybe.
I guess I need to give the channel to Al now. It's his channel.
There we go. Yeah, one thing I did like that you pointed out is that IP is like necessarily terms for, well, this is one way of looking at it. I'm sure there might be people who disagree with this, and it may not be 100% correct, but you can think about property rights as like terms for engaging with other people. Like, you can look at these things in two ways. It's like, what can I do with my property and what can I stop other people from doing with my property, right? So on the flip side of that, what can you stop other people from doing with your property? It's like, oh, well, they can't take it and I can use force to do that. And basically all of these things come down to, you know, you can use force to prevent them from doing X, Y, or Z. And IP, if we're going to account it as property, necessarily must be included in that. So kind of like I was talking about earlier, and this thing must be applied universalizably. It can't be picking and choosing. So if one kind of digital anything is, all kinds of digital anything are. So that time that I copied that image from Google and I didn't, you know, consult the person who made the image and et cetera, yada, yada, I'm a full-blown state of nature being now that can be, you know, held to whatever standards the person wants to for getting their just desserts for me violating their property rights. And that's an important ramification to keep in mind, because I think a lot of the discussion on IP is around ramifications, like, oh, you know, I won't make money on this if people are copying it or whatever, or, you know, it'll devalue my work or something like that. It usually comes down to some kind of level of value. But there's another side to this coin where the ramifications also extend to everybody else. And that necessarily makes all of these people who do this non-violent, very benign thing, property rights violators. And that has very big ramifications.
Yeah. Keep that in mind. Don't forget. It's mine.
Yeah.
I know y'all are dying to share this. So
I already screen grabbed it. I put it on a t-shirt and I've sold 10 of them since the show started.
Well,
don't copy this NFT. Don't copy it.
You owe me, James. You owe me.
I'll pay you under the table.
Oh, baby.
Sorry, can I see that again real quick, Patrick? 1 second. What? Can I see that picture again?
No!
And hold it real still.
No! You're trying to steal from me. No, here you go.
Give me just 1 second here.
All right, you know, you could get some support for the channel here, some financial support. Let's auction that thick thing off. Let's auction this picture of Christian. Yeah.
Christian?
Well, Christian. Oh, no, my gamer's too high.
Oh, that wasn't Christian?
Me?
What'd you do, man? Christian?
No.
I didn't see it, Christian. What'd you do?
I copied it, but you can't. It's in pencil, so it's it's kind of coming through. It's not doing too well.
You have that AI blurring thing going on.
Shit, that's what it is.
Artificial intelligence.
There we go.
Oh.
I've stolen the intellectual property. It is mine.
You just
now
devalued Patrick's picture.
Yep. Yes. All that money I was gonna make is gone now.
Gone.
All right. Alfredo
and
says
so
I was just trying too hard.
If intellectual property stands, I am now a state of nature being. Mr. James Freeman, am I a state of nature being right now?
I don't think so.
Okay.
No.
I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah. So we couldn't attack him. Though literally, you know, quite literally,
nope.
I could sue him in government court for copyright, you know, copyright violation right now.
Right, but government isn't legitimate. So yeah, we'll go by some legitimate, you know, reasonable codes and standards and ethics.
Well, yeah, sure. Like, assuming in a free society, if intellectual property were a thing, I could sue him in whatever court that existed
yep.
in there for that, you know, and yep. have men with guns extract resources from him for his sins. I mean, crimes.
Right.
How much for that NFT screenshot? I can mint it as an NFT tonight.
I'll screenshot it. Put it on Twitter.
And there's an excellent way to actually, what is the word? Hold on to your intellectual property, an NFT, right?
It depends on what
essentially
you mean.
Yeah. It's
essentially an NFT can't be replicated. Is that right?
No.
The specific
this is a good example. This is a good example of the faux scarcity that cryptocurrency provides. Like, a Bitcoin is scarce only within the rules of the Bitcoin network, but not in reality. Those digits and patterns of data can be copied infinitely. There is no scarcity there in reality. It's only within the rules of the Bitcoin network. So yeah, within the rules of the NFT cryptocurrency network, NFTs are scarce. But in reality, it's just a picture like everything else. Yeah. If you keep stealing Patrick's IP, you might devolve into one, Christian. Yeah, exactly. Yep. Copyright, is that part of the system? Yeah, so this goes for copyright. This goes for patents. This goes for trade secrets. This goes for, what else? Blackmail. Blackmail laws are kind of like, they're kind of like, hey, I'm going to release this private data if you don't give me whatever. You know, I don't even know if that would be a crime. I think that would just be really shitty behavior. You don't have a right to control what somebody else does with their property. And if their property contains a pattern of some incriminating images, you don't have any kind of right to tell them not to release those images. You better pay up if you want to, you know, whatever. So yeah, those are the kind of the dirtiest circumstances around IP that most people are uncomfortable with. Trademark is
a good
another
rule of thumb.
Trademark is another one people have a problem with, right? Like, because that involves fraud a lot, you know, like if I sell a product under somebody else's trademark, then they think that the problem there is that the intellectual property called trademark has been violated, when in reality, it's just a fraud crime. I'm defrauding people. I'm selling them a product that they think is somebody else's product because I'm using, it's like what happened with James. Like James has, James had that dude on TikTok, which is like the cancer of the internet, by the way. it's like mental health makes you get you clout there. Anyway, mental health issues gets you popularity on TikTok. Anyway, yeah. So he had a guy fraudulently, I think, making money, right? On reposting your content. And so people were viewing his content and he was making money fraudulently. That's a different crime. Like that's not theft. It's just fraud, which is a property crime. Yeah.
You know, I really don't like confrontations.
Yeah, go ahead.
James, what?
I really don't like confrontations either, so I wasn't even upset that he was making money off of it. Again, the whole thing was that my whole problem was that he was pretending to be me and people actually thought he was me, so.
Yep.
There may be like one or two examples that I can't think of in the top of my head, but essentially, if you can't touch it or hold it in your hand or something like that, it's intellectual property. If you can put your hands on it in some capacity, then it almost certainly falls under the rules of property. So that's just an easy way if somebody would like to think, oh, is this thing intellectual property or is it not? That's a rule of thumb, per se, you could use.
Oh, we got good. So I do own my customers because I can put my hands on them.
We got some good comments coming in. So the first good comment is again from Alfredo. He says blackmail is just negotiating with an advantage.
I like it.
And then Noble Phoenix makes an important point. So I'm calling this person that is sharing Larkin's videos, hurting his ability to pay his bills, a really shitty person. And Noble Phoenix says, well, maybe it's shitty behavior to not share the content that could benefit all mankind. Maybe it's shitty behavior to not put out his Candles in the Dark videos behind a paywall. It's shitty behavior to not release that to the public to help the world. Yeah, that could be your assessment of the situation. That's the difference between violence and shitty behavior. That's the difference between what I would call a moral evil and what I would call aesthetic opinion. Like one wouldn't allow a violent response, which is not what we're talking about here, and the other one is just our differing opinions on what shitty behavior is. I think the Metallica Black Album was their best album. You might think that's shitty behavior and you might have a different opinion on which album is the best one. That's fine, we can disagree, but neither of us can punch each other over those opinions. And I can't punch the guy releasing Larkin's content. I think it's shitty behavior. You might think it's shitty of Larkin to paywall it. Those opinions, it's just your opinion, man. Just like you said, we're allowed to have these differing opinions on matters of aesthetics because no violence has been initiated. Not counting the contractual agreement this person made when he paid for the content and agreed not to download it and violated that contract, which makes it beyond shitty behavior, which means that this person should owe some kind of restitution to Larkin. But,
Or be punched in the face.
Yeah. State of nature, baby.
State of nature, baby. Oh, man.
Yep. Okay.
Go ahead. Oh, I was just going to say, I've been writing a book for the better part of 2 years now, which hopefully will be coming out in the summer. I said winter last summer, but we'll see. And I'm going to charge a small amount of money for it because I spent, you know, years working on it, but I can't go out and with the IP stick and start beating people if I find out they have a PDF of my book or something. So, it's just the way it is. It's just the way the rules work. And it has to necessarily for everything to be universalizable and to be non-arbitrary. And
So I would like to give James sort of the last word on this topic because he initiated the conversation. I'd like to hear where he is now, and we don't have to have changed his mind. He can just want to think about it more, you know, whatever. I just want to let James close this out. And then maybe if you guys are down to spend a little bit more time on stream, maybe we can talk about our standards for friends, which was the conversation Shepard and I were having. Is that cool with you guys? Yep. All right. So James, why don't you have the last word on copyright for today?
Yeah. First off, I just want to say, Christian, if I could read, I would steal a take a PDF of your book without paying for it. Patrick's going to be teaching me how to read soon, though. So look out. I think I came out of here a lot more enlightened. I think you guys made a lot of good points. And I think you guys know too, I didn't come in here necessarily on one side or the other. But like I said, I'm very much not totally convinced. And I still don't know that I'm totally convinced. I don't think that in any discussion or debate that I ever walk away in that moment with a totally different mindset. But I always go back and I re-listen and review check my ideas, you know, with the principles that I claim to believe in, and until I get it aligned and figure out, you know, and truly comprehend it. I think you guys made some excellent points that really helped me out, especially the one with Christian where he was saying, you know, essentially you don't have a right to profit off of your so-called intellectual property. Essentially, by saying that I have a right to profit, I'm profiting off of a specific customer. That means that I own that customer and nobody else can. So there's some real fallacies. There's some real issues with a belief in intellectual property here that I hadn't seen before. So I appreciate the conversation, guys.
Makes me so happy. This is like why I do this channel. Like, this is all I'm here for, is just to like cause people to think new thoughts occasionally. This is great. Shepard, maybe I can give you the steering wheel now. I'm interested if you're interested in continuing this conversation about standards of friends, the different types of friends, the what you mean by your stuff where the guy doesn't want you to make kissy faces at his wife or he'll punch you. If you want to take that topic up again, I think it'd be fun for us to talk about if you guys have time and are interested.
Yes, my thought is more of what we will tolerate, and we have this. I think we need to separate when we sit in our ivory towers as we are this evening, and we have three brilliant minds, and I came along for the ride as well, and we're all discussing these big good ideas, and I think that especially, I mean, Christian is such a rigorous philosopher kind of dude that I want to disagree with him on things, and then I listen to him like, yeah, damn it, he's right. And so there's that world of philosophical purity, deep thought, high IQ chatting. And then when we hang up the phone tonight, because I'm old, I think that's what we're doing. We hang up the phone and we walk out of our house. We walk into a very imperfect world. And in this imperfect world, 99.9% of people aren't paying attention to philosophy. They're watching sports ball. They just don't care about this stuff. They just don't care. And so if and until one of us is able to successfully start a good, strong cult in which we can all move into a community and live happily ever after, until that time, I'm going to have the neighbor Slim who has some rules that I don't like. And so then the question becomes, in the real world, not what's morally right or wrong, but in the real world, how much will I tolerate? And I won't tolerate him keeping Jews out of the neighborhood, but I will tolerate him saying, don't make kissy faces at my wife. And I don't know where that line is, but we've kind of got to get along with our less thinking neighbors. We don't gotta get along with them. I choose to get along with my less thinking neighbors because we'll check mail for each other when the other one's out of town for a week. You know, it's just handy to be good neighbors.
Yeah, I don't disagree with any of that. Like my neighbor next door is a fucking Beto voter. You know, Beto, the politician here in Texas that has literally said the words, we're coming for your guns, like deal with it. Like, he's my enemy in pretty much every way I can think of, Beto. And so this guy next door is trying to give that guy power over me. That's an egregious violation of any kind of reciprocated rights that me and my neighbor could have between us. Like, I don't trust that person. Don't like that person because of it. I'm not going to be friends with that person. I'm not going to invite them over to the house for dinner. If they came over and asked to borrow some cream, just out of kind of like that thing that you're talking about where, you know, you kind of need to be on speaking terms with your neighbors, I'd probably give them some cream. I'm not like cussing him every time I see him out in his driveway. I'm moderating my behavior, or, you know, maybe what I'd like to do to that guy, for the sake of consanguinity, I guess would be the way to say that. Like, you know, we need to be on speaking terms because we are neighbors and that's the fact of life, like you're saying. But he's not going to be my friend. He's not going to be trusted. He's not going to, like I said, he's not going to be in my social circles. I'm going to keep him on the outside with all the other people I don't trust that want to control me. But you know, I see what you're saying. There's a certain level of I don't know, common behavior that you have to keep just to survive in a society, especially in a city where you're surrounded by 50 neighbors are within, you know, 300 yards of me. So, you know, I can't just be fully principled, at all costs, or I would have a very bad time here. But I guess there's a difference between that and like who I would consider a friend, and maybe our uses of the word friend are probably just being used differently. What I consider a friend, to me, a friend is like I don't want to say holy. It's a super, super, super special treasured label that I only give people that have really earned it. Like the people on the screen right now, I would consider my friends, and I consider them my friends because I know that 100% of the time, none of you guys are going to punch somebody for somebody making kissy faces at your wives because you hold principles higher than even your egos. And those are my standards for what I consider a friend. So we're just probably using different language. It's probably a word difference rather than anything, but yeah. Anybody else want to comment, Christian?
I think the first thing I was going to say was that I use the word friend in like a very exclusive way. So it is like designed to filter out as many humans on planet Earth as possible. And the very tippy top of that list, if I cannot trust you to respect my rights, you do not meet the criteria of a friend. End of story. Now, you could say acquaintances, people I am friendly to. There may be people who exist in that sphere that are not my friends. But like, I have a general rule of thumb that's like, if you live within 100 yards of somebody, you should try not to piss them off. So I'll make some concessions here and there to not piss people that live within 100 yards of me off. But I think that's like a distinction that I make. It's like being friendly towards someone, which is kind of like my default, because I like to assume that most people I meet are not total pieces of shit until proven otherwise. And then like friends, which is a very like, that's a very important idea to me. And I keep my friend group small for a reason, because it makes things a lot easier. It's got a utilitarian aspect of it to it as well, because it does just make a lot of things a lot easier if you only trust people who you can trust, and treat everyone else friendly, but with that, you know, 10-foot pole separating you. So,
James, what do you think?
I'm a little more with Shepherd. I mean, I agree. There are people who I don't let get as close unless they are willing to not beat the crap out of people for making kissy faces at their wife. But I'm willing to let a lot of people who don't understand the non-aggression principle in a lot closer than I think some of you guys are. And the reason is because a lot of times I can understand where they're at. And while it wouldn't be okay for me to do it, a lot of people I think are working with the knowledge that they have, and they're trying to be the best that they can with the knowledge that they have. And, you know, this neighbor who thinks it's okay to punch someone for making kissy faces at his wife, he's been raised and indoctrinated that way to think that that's okay. And so I know that that's his line, and so I'm not going to cross it. And so I feel like I can associate with him and know where his lines are at. But again, it can be a slippery slope, because if he's willing to do that, there can always be that question of, okay, well, where is and isn't he willing to use aggression? I know this one thing But is there other areas where he's willing to use aggression against nonviolent people? I'm still willing to let them in, though. And I think that letting people, like, not completely, though, not like I'm going to actually trust someone like you guys who will genuinely always respect me and my rights to my person, myself. But I think that it's important to let, for me to let these people in a little bit, because it makes it so that I'm actually able to express my ideas to them. So that I can explain to this guy, hey man, I don't think it's really right for you to punch somebody for making, like, I agree, this guy's a POS, a piece of crap for making kissy faces at your wife, but I can't share my ideas with him if I don't let him in enough, you know, to that he at least trusts me a little bit and respects me. That's just how I feel about it.
That's a good point. Well made. And Shepard made that in his video as well, is like, if we don't engage with people around us that don't understand the basics of the philosophy of non-aggression, then we won't really wake anybody up. I think he said the word proselytize, which is exactly what I do a lot on this channel, is trying to reach people that aren't there yet and try to teach them a few things and wake them up. And so, like, you know, if my neighbor and I were in a conversation, I would engage with him and I'd say, hey, you know, there's no right to control what I own peacefully in my house, right? And you shouldn't support a politician that wants to violently control me like that, right? Like, I would say it to him just like that. I would never do that to you. I would never, ever try to control what you own peacefully inside your house. I would respect you too much for that. You know, I would say things like that. And if I'm not associating with them at all, like if I'm just cussing at him from his driveway, which I'm not, like that conversation would never happen. So there is a line there. Yeah, I agree. There's a lot of good comments happening. Let me catch up on them. Oh, Shepard, go ahead.
I just wanted to toss out that a lot of what gave me this idea was this book by Lavoie Finicum, Only by Blood and Suffering. Kind of, it's a Louis L'Amour / John Wesley Rawls or whatever, the prepper guy. It's a combination fiction book. And after reading it, I realized this guy is so different than me. He's an... is everybody okay?
What's happening?
I'm sorry, it's my dog. He's 13 years old. He clears his throat. And I'm sorry. He'll probably do it again.
So we have a full endorsement from your dog for this book. Bye now.
He's like, what a great book.
Sorry, Jeanette.
I was reaching for the mute. I just couldn't find the mute button. I was like, oh, he's doing the thing.
I need that as a sound effect on my soundboard, so like just randomly, yeah, if somebody's absolutely saying something I disagree with, I can be like
exactly. But wow. After reading this book, I kind of came to, oh, okay, mic drop. I can't compete. Look at this guy.
Oh, we missed it. Bring him up again.
Oh, okay.
And he also doesn't like a lot of Lavoie Finicum's ideas. Yeah.
That's a good boy. Oh.
So after reading that book, I kind of came to the conclusion that, you know what? Yeah, this guy and I disagree. He's LDS. He's very different than me in some ways. And yet, kind of the sentence that I walked away thinking is, I could be neighbors with that dude. And of course, I can't now because he was assassinated a few years ago. But the type of guy that the fictional character was, the way he wrote it, I'm like, yeah, I could be neighbors with this guy, even though we disagree, even on some serious state of nature issues.
I don't know why everybody in the comments is asking us to make duck faces. I don't get the joke. Maybe I missed something. Everybody wants us to make kissy faces. Everybody wants us to make kissy faces. No. This is not TikTok. Go look at TikTok for
your
stupid
wife.
People doing tricks. All right. Let's see. We got a tip over on Odyssey. That Moose says, tip 25. Thank you, sir. Appreciate you. If IP laws didn't exist, would there be a need for this conversation? Property rights are derived from self-ownership. IP rights are derived from existence of the state. Who wants to take that first? I'll take it first if nobody else disagrees.
I think that people, like, I think it's very natural for people to feel entitled to the product of their works in general.
Yeah.
And in a lot of cases, that's justly earned, right? A lot of people do put work into great products that get sold, and they have a right to sell those things, and, you know, they make their money off of it. But I think we live in an age of technology that our little monkey brains just weren't really designed to work in. So it's hard for, we'll just say, the common person to make the delineation between building something or a product or something like that and creating something online that then falls under the purview of intellectual property because it's a pattern. To them, it's the same kind of calculus. They put work into something, they deserve to be compensated for it. So I don't know. I think it would be a less prominent issue because there wouldn't be a body to enforce it, but I think it would still be a conversation.
Your dog sounds like an eldritch horror, says Alfredo. Dog's got COVIDs. Someone call that dog an ambulance. There you go. Those are the comments. yeah, so he says if IP laws didn't exist, would there be a need for this conversation? Yeah, I think so. I think the desire for this kind of thing to exist would exist even if the state didn't exist. People want, like Christian was just saying, they want their effort to be protected and to be rewarded, and they'll seek out systems and agreements with people that make that happen. I mean, in a way, the government is downstream of culture, and the culture demands intellectual property type protections. And so the government does that so that it can make people think it's helping them. If people didn't want that, it's likely the government wouldn't provide that to a certain degree. That's kind of the argument against government in general. It's like a good example of that argument would be with charity. It's like they say, well, the poor wouldn't be helped without the government stepping in and providing charity. It's like, no, the reason why the government is doing charity is because there's a massive demand from everyone living here that something be done to help these people. And that massive innate internal demand to help people would still exist in absence of the government. They would just, you know, be, that demand would be satisfied in other ways. And then he says property rights are derived from self-ownership. This is a very, very common saying, a very common cliche in libertarian circles, that property rights stem from or are derived from self-ownership. I disagree. Again, I think rights are mutual reciprocal understandings between people. They are derived literally just from us forming agreements between ourselves to respect each other. That's not a derivation from self-ownership. Self-ownership is a mutual agreement. Like, I'm agreeing that you guys own yourself. I will not punch you. And in return, I demand that you do not punch me. That's what self-ownership is. It's that mutual agreement. It's not something mystical. It is literally to get us out of that state of nature where we're all treating each other like animals. We are making mutual agreements with each other. That's what rights are. Oh boy, we have more animals. Okay. No, I'm jealous.
This one will destroy my apartment if I let him go. So he has to sit here for the rest of the show. Sorry.
How old is he?
Probably 5 months. He's a rescue. So yeah, we're not 100% sure, but cute. Less than 6 months for sure.
Yeah, it has to make it to a soundboard, somebody says. Another interesting intellectual property fact is that somebody wrote a computer algorithm. I know I'm kind of going back to a previous topic, but it's in response to a comment. Somebody made a computer algorithm that generated the music for every possible combination of notes up to something like 5 minutes long. And they stored that in a database. So they've technically now, according to IP law, they own the copyright to every possible song that has not yet already been produced. Because they were the first one to create it. Just to kind of illustrate sort of the absurdity of it. Like, now, any new music that's created, they would have to pay royalties to this person that developed this computer algorithm.
That's, you know, powerful.
I don't know. I don't know how much time we've got left, Patrick, but I was also questioning property rights and thinking about some things recently. And there are some people who will claim that they own huge, vast amounts of land and resources. And so where is there ever a line drawn there? I mean, I think it was old Jewish law that said that a man is entitled to the land that he works. But I'm sure you guys understand more than me where do these philosophies come from, and where is the line on what somebody can claim on this earth in finite resources as theirs?
I have like a 30-minute rant I could go on if you're that's what you're looking for. Go ahead, Christian.
I think the easiest way, the most succinct way to put it, is that property rights, as we've been talking about them, ownership is always in orders of highest claim. Mm-hmm. So you can have a highest claim in a number of different ways, but that's essentially how we do this. So if you let's say you buy a quadrillion acres of land from somebody, from a bunch of different people who all had the highest claim to that land, and then they all contractually sign it over to you, that now gives you the highest claim to that land. And that's kind of the end of the road, right? There isn't like a cap of like, you must work these things. It's whoever has the highest claim. And if that highest claim is transferred to you, you could sit on it and never do anything with it. You retain that highest claim until you willingly separate with it or die, I guess. But then it gets, you know, transferred to the estate maybe if you set that up. So
Go ahead.
Setting up an estate, is that a statist idea as well, though? I mean, that's done through the state.
Well, there would be a consent. It's like corporations are, you know, that's like saying corporations are a faculty of the state. Similar things would exist in private polite society, you know.
So it comes down to like what is the, so if rights are agreements between people, it comes down to what rights or what rules, property rules, do you choose to reciprocate with people? And again, we should be on a quest to sort of find the most universal, the most rational, the most effective set of rules that we can for reciprocating property rights. Effective being judged in terms of its capacity to reduce conflict over scarce resources, and universalizable in that it whatever these rules are should not have a bunch of subjective use cases where, oh, this is how property rights work on the moon, and this is how they work in Texas, and that's how they work in Germany. Like, these rules should be able to work everywhere at all times between all people. Mm-hmm. Because that makes them better at reducing conflict over them. And so then I just have to sort of espouse, I think the farthest that we've come on refining these rules is just sort of the first use property right. Get there first, make first use of a thing that affords you the highest claim to that property. Now, the subjectivity that's inherent to get there first is pretty non-subjective. You should be able to prove when you got there before other people. You would say, hey, I got here first. Here's this picture of that I took on this day with this timestamp or whatever, you know, something like that. That's pretty definite. That's pretty objective. And if somebody else showed up with a picture that they had gotten there before you, well, then they would gain the upper hand on that specific point. The subjectivity comes in a little bit when you talk about first use. What constitutes making first use of a thing? If I stand on the top of a hill and I look out over a vast swath of land and I say, wow, I'm really enjoying the view, and so I'm using all of this land to provide me a nice view, so therefore I have made first use of, you know, 300 acres of land as far as the eye can see. Well, how many people are going to reciprocate that kind of property ownership with you? I doubt very many people. And so there is a little bit of subjectivity left in it. There is a lot less subjectivity than a lot of the previous property ethics that involve things like separating it from nature, mixing your labor with it, which is kind of a commie labor theory of value thing that should be rejected. Because first of all, what constitutes separating it from nature? What if it's a worm farm and you need to leave the ground undisturbed, but you know, you're using it, you're farming worms under the ground, you just can't see them. Well, you've made use of it, but you can't really separate it from nature. Mixing your labor with it, what does labor have to do with anything? You know, like, these are all just, these just add subjectivity and points of conflict into the property system. So again, I think we are smartest when we choose to reciprocate rules with people that reduce all this conflict and just make it as rational and as universalizable as possible. I wouldn't reciprocate a property right with you that let you just kind of walk around the earth visiting mountains and claiming everything the eye could see. You know, I wouldn't reciprocate that with you. So I guess that's my answer. At the end of the day, we are animals and the resources are scarce. And if we can't come up with agreements to keep ourselves from fighting each other, then we're going to fight each other. That's just that's reality. And I hate it when people try and gloss over reality. Like, we live in a state of nature where, you know, violence to get what we want is the default state of existence, always has been, between all animals and all creatures and all humans. And it's us that have these higher reasoning faculties that are able to elevate ourselves out of it by making agreements. Like, I choose to not attack you, and I hope and I demand that you don't attack me. And in doing so, we're both able to make ourselves and our families safer and more successful and more healthy and just more successful in general. So that's our superpower as humans, is that we have the smarts to be able to do that.
Well said.
And everyone's asleep. Oh, okay. let's see.
I was just going to say real quick, just the good part about the making first use of thing is that we don't really have to deal much with that unless we, you know, dissolve the federal government and then have to deal with all that unowned land. Existing in reality right now as we do, it's not really a concern for us. We're mostly focused on like who has the highest claim to what.
Right.
But yes, I do agree that like if the, you know, federal government were to be dissolved tomorrow and then all the national lands became unowned, just wild lands with no one with a proper claim to them, then we would have a lot of work to do. But that's, you know, maybe that's best abridged across at a later time.
All right, last comment, and then I guess we can wrap up. Outlaw Barber says, and I'm bringing this up last because we might be doing a stream on Saturday that relates to it. He says, Mark Passio has a good rights and wrong saying. A right is when your behavior does not cause physical harm to another sentient being, and a wrong is when your behavior does cause harm to other beings. I'm pretty sure at this point I disagree with just about everything Mark Passio has ever said. that's hyperbolic. But what constitutes harm is interminably subjective. My surgeon is causing harm to my body when he does surgery, when he cuts me open. But you know, I asked him to because I'm hoping that he'll save my life in the process of harming me. Some people enjoy being harmed. On TikTok.
Yeah, it's a fetish sometimes.
Yeah. And the judgment of applying a right or a wrong to a harm is something that isn't found in nature. That is something that he is applying as a judgment from his mind onto interactions between beings. That is not something objective, as he tries to say it is. It's not a science. It's not a morality from first principles. It's not based on, you know, any kind of universal natural law. It's just him judging behavior that harms sentient beings as right or wrong. And we can all make those judgments, but we cannot say that we are espousing some sort of objective scientific natural law morality. Okay. So, this all began with me questioning something I heard years ago from Mark Passio. And since I did that, his followers have continually brought me more and more of his work, saying, oh, well, here's the answer. Here's the rebuttal to your problem or to the flaw that you found in Mark Passio's work. And so the conversation has escalated. That's exactly what I'm constantly asking people to do. So for that, I thank you guys. I'm constantly asking you guys, tell me if you think I'm wrong, show me I'm wrong, make the arguments. And you have done that and you are doing that. And this is not a complaint. I just want to make sure that when I continue escalating the conversation and engaging more and more with Passio's work and Passio's arguments, that you don't think I'm like obsessed with him or something. I'm doing this in response to all of you bringing me his arguments like I asked. So if you think you have a better argument, you did, you brought it to me, and now we're going to engage with it. And I'm going to probably do that a little bit longer before I feel like I've kind of satisfied the discussion. And then I'm going to move on with my life. Like, I'm not on a jihad against Passio. He is a prominent figure in the liberty space. And so we're going to deal with what I consider to be flawed philosophy that comes from him and is widely held amongst people. And that's fine. We're going to do it respectfully. We're going to do it constructively. And we are going to either find out we're wrong or we're going to move on with life. And so to that end, hopefully Saturday, this is still tentative, so don't hold me to it, but hopefully Saturday, me and three other people, only one of which I will announce now, but Christian is one of them, are going to do a marathon live stream where we take his 8.5-hour seminar on natural law, and we are going to start live streaming, and we are going to sit through his seminar as students. and we're going to be pausing it. We're going to be analyzing it. We're going to be breaking it down. We're going to be providing commentary, rebuttals, or agreements if he gets it right or wrong. And we are going to do our best to take his ideas seriously, take them in a polite manner and respectful manner, and engage with them openly, honestly. And we're going to, I believe, hopefully, successfully show you the fundamental flaws and missing bricks in the wall that is Mark Passio's conception of natural law. The stream is probably going to be 16 hours long, so probably six of you are going to watch it. And that's fine, because for me, this is about the intellectual combat over ideas. And a lot of you are very into his ideas, and so it necessarily is important to me to engage with them in a genuine way. So hopefully this weekend on Saturday, it's going to be a long one. You're welcome to hang out. And it's probably going to be a little bit informal just because of how long it is. We're probably going to have to be able to get up and take breaks and such, but we're going to do it, and we're going to do it all the way as good as we can. Let's go around the circle. Let's start with Christian, then Shepard, then James. Any last words for the show today?
IP is really dumb. Don't buy into it. Property is king. And it's all about highest claims. And you can read a whole lot more on this topic it's probably stuff that we haven't even come close to covering, just because there is a wealth of knowledge in the property space and in just general libertarian thought. And 90% of it is really good. So you should be able to see the 10% throws off the red flags. But keep reading, keep learning, and don't take any of our word at face value. Verify it for yourself, and then you will be that much stronger in your determination one way or another.
All right. Hey, good to see you, King, over on Float. Good to see you. Let's see. Outlaw Barber just donated $2 on YouTube. Thank you for that. He says, I want you and Mark to have a conversation. Outlaw, thank you for donating. That is awesome of you. I have reached out in three different ways now and have been turned down twice. A conversation with Mark Passio is not going to happen. And look, like, anytime I've disagreed with people in the past, step one for me is inviting them on the show to talk with them directly, to have the disagreement with the horse's mouth, so to speak, to let them show up and defend their ideas rather than doing that shitty YouTube thing where people just get on and clip up what the other person says and do like a takedown video with a talking head. I don't like that. I don't think that content is very productive. So step one for me was to reach out to Passio and invite him on the show. Step one was we were going to have a debate. Hopefully he was invited to debate at the Anarchapoco event. We were going to actually engage openly on it. Denied. Then a separate request was put through for an informal conversation. Denied. It's not happening. The guy's not showing up for his positions. I've tried. And so I'm left with no option than to do the thing that I really don't really think is as productive, but it's all I got, which is going to be to engage with the content he's created on YouTube. So here we go. I'm not happy about it. I'm going to try and do it as respectful as possible, but without him showing up for his beliefs in person, it's going to be more one-sided than I prefer. I don't want it to be one-sided. I want him there to tell me when I'm misinterpreting something. Denied. I can't do anything more than that. The invitation's been made. Shepard? Last words?
My wrap up. Yeah, last words are to pander to your audience. those of you listening to this, watching this, you're the cream of the intellectual crop. Like, really, how many people care about big ideas like this and like to listen to this content and make comments and really delve into stuff and figure out how all of us human critters are going to best get along with each other and make the best of this life? So I guess I would just say, thank you. You and we are the hope for the future. Let's keep thinking and exploring and having an open mind to better ideas and growing and getting better. Thanks for joining us.
Mr. Freeman.
Yeah. I just want to say thank you for having me on the show, Patrick, and letting me express my statist ideas and picking them apart for me so that I can comprehend. You know, like Christian just said a minute ago, don't take our word for it and figure it out for yourself. And, you know, honestly, I'm not the quickest learner. I'm really not, but I am someone who I'm not going to stop until I truly comprehend and wrap my head around something. So it's nice to be able to have somewhere like this that I can come and these ideas can be discussed in a respectful way so that, you know, I can really listen to and comprehend what you're saying so that I can understand.
Hell yeah, man. What we have here really feels rare. Like, I don't know if I'm just in my own head with that, but I don't see this content created very often anywhere else. And so I'm proud to have you guys as friends and, you know, as people willing to come on and talk through this stuff. You guys are awesome. And like Shepard said, this audience is weird too. Like, y'all are weird wanting to like sit here for 2 hours and listen to this nerdy talk about rights and intellectual property and stuff. Holy crap. Y'all are rare too. So as rare as I find that this group of people that I get to talk to, I find that you guys that are willing to watch it are rare as hell too. And I appreciate all of you. And the people that donate and support the show, even more rare. Thanks guys for putting your resources where your principles are and showing the confidence of that. Yeah, giving us the confidence of your resources. Thank you very much. All right. I guess that's it, guys. I guess we can wrap it up there. Maybe we'll see you this weekend for a marathon run. And, you know, Shepard, James, Christian, as always, if you guys ever want to talk about anything, open door, guys. Let's do it. All right.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching.
Good night, guys.